Outrocast.
Recording in progress. Is your take on Fine there so far there, Olivia?
Yes, I am. What about you?
Nonstop, but good. Thank you very much. Pleasure to connect. Congratulations on signing with Universal. Your full length is out in a couple of weeks. How long did you have to keep a secret that you were signing to Universal?
Oh, crazy. I think it was about maybe like a 4-month process now. It's so hard to think back. I feel like COVID's just made my timeline of life very blurred. But yeah, it's very exciting news to share.
So the album was written before you signed with Universal?
Partially, yes.
Partially.
Yes, and we've popped out some songs here and there, but yeah, I can't believe it's almost time. It's wild.
Wow. How many songs did you pare down to before deciding that it was the full track list for the album?
So I think we narrowed it down to about 10 songs, and then we decided for the album we're going to have eight songs, but it's always so hard to do that narrowing down process.
I can imagine it is. Do you remember the first one that you wrote or co-wrote for the album?
That's actually a good question. I believe the first song I wrote was one of the acoustic ballads called The Walls. And so it was fun to kind of have that song. And then we ended up also building some really fun pop songs. So there's something on the album for everyone. It's great.
Yeah, I agree with that. Now the song Sad to See You Happy. I'm curious about how something like that is written, because the title is hooky. Mm-hmm. The riff is hooky. The chorus is hooky. What came first?
That's also a good question. You're making me think here. I think
I'm sorry for the thinking. If you wanted to say, who are your influences? Do you like pizza?
Yeah, exactly. No, so I believe what came first was we had this guitar loop going, which you hear throughout the whole song. So yeah. The instrumental melody came first. And then I believe we started with a chorus. I think my coworker is going to text me like, we didn't start with the chorus. But in my memory, that's what we started with. And then we went back and wrote the verse. And then at the beginning of the song, you hear like all these da-da-doos and these fun little
hooks.
And that was something we went and added after the song was written. So yeah, but it's so fun to play with all these hooks. It was great. I'm glad it's catchy.
I call that ear candy. There's a lot going on in the song in a very good way. So when you said at the beginning that there was a guitar loop that was playing, so somebody brought the guitar loop to the table, and was it playing for like 2 hours or was it playing for 5 minutes or no, any recollection?
Yeah, it definitely played for a long time. So I think we sat there for probably an hour or so. And again, every session is so different. Sometimes you hear it 5 minutes, you have a vocal hook written. Other times you just have to listen over and over and over. And it's funny because as a musician, I feel like you just get used to that. But as someone else, if they were to just come in the room, they'd be like, what the heck is going on? What are you listening to? But yeah, we listened for a long time. And you also have to take breaks sometimes too, right? You just hear it so much. You're like, hey, we need to go outside, take a breath of fresh air. And then sometimes that idea will come when you're taking that break. Otherwise, when you're coming back in, sometimes that's all it takes to get that moment.
Got it. Were any of the songs written virtually rather than being in the room with the co-writer?
Yeah, so two of the songs actually. Sad to See You Happy, we had one of the writers on Zoom. And then I was with two other guys in the studio. And then for one of the songs on the album called Dominoes, I did a Zoom session with some people in LA.
So, wow. Yeah. Wow. So not awkward. If you've done it more than once, either someone's making you do it or it's not awkward.
Yeah, it's not awkward, but it's definitely the whole technical component is not ideal, is how I would phrase it. Because you can't be being in the studio and just kind of going back and forth with someone, right? You have an idea, and then let's say you're trying to sing it, but then it's delayed. It can kind of get lost in translation a bit. But hey, I'll take it over not having a session anything.
Yeah, a lot of the top pop performers and rock performers who have used co-writers, songs that they have written that didn't make their album, which they did with a collaborator, sometimes wound up being cut by other artists. Do you, with having some leftovers, start going, maybe we can get these out there? Or when you don't use a song, do you say, maybe the next album?
Yeah, it's funny you say that. I haven't actually thought a lot about kind of giving those songs to someone else. But I mean, I would love that to do that one day, but I think I am still so early on that in working on this next project, I'll keep those to myself for a little bit, see if they make that cut. And then maybe if not, that's when I could start showing some other people. But yeah, it's definitely a really fun and interesting concept to explore.
Now, you started as a teenager. If the bio is correct, the Winnipeg Folk Festival, which you were playing at when you're 14, which shows that you're a long-term artist. This is not, hey, we think we didn't get something out of her. But I'm curious, when was the moment that it went from being, this is a fun thing to do, to this is a career?
Yeah, so I just gotta think back. I think when I was about 17 or 18, I put out, independently put out an EP. I had 4 songs. It's actually no longer online, but at the time it was a really big deal for me. And right after that is when the whole launch show happened, and I was scouted for that show. So I think really going on that show and being launched, essentially launched my career and really let me meet some incredible people and grow my team slowly. So that moment, and that's also when I quit my minimum wage job and I decided I was just gonna try to do this. So it's been a process, but yeah, lots has happened in a little time for sure.
Is the long-term goal to be just a musician, or do you have that, well, I have the name for my empire, and my empire, which is my fashion line and my chain of restaurants, is this, this, and this. I find it's 2 categories of performers these days.
For sure. I mean, it's so hard. I feel like I definitely want to get that artist thing down packed before I start exploring other avenues. But as someone who's really like into fashion and health and wellness, I mean, starting a brand would be incredible one day too. You're making me think, this is great. Years are turning.
Hopefully you got some coffee in you first, that yes. Like me, I'm not the person or the thing that's waking you up, that it's
coffee. No, I am. I woke up early today, so you're good.
The almighty press day. And something I couldn't figure out, because if you start out with the acoustic kind of thing, but mm-hmm. also the TV angle, but then you worked with Boy Wanda, and so you've worked with R&B centric and hip hop oriented producers as well. You kind of run the gamut. Do you have a first favorite artist, your first concert, your first CD kind of artist?
I think the first concert my dad ever took me to, and he took me to so many growing up, was Hilary Duff. Yeah, and I just remember watching that. We had seats like in the nosebleeds in the really high section, have like binoculars looking. And I just remember being so excited and so curious how someone got to do that for a job. And I think that really sparked the, I want to do this as a job one day. How can I get there? So, but yeah. So I listened to so many artists growing up though, from Fleetwood Mac to Coldplay to Norah Jones to Hilary Duff. So I definitely had a broad spectrum of influences.
Which venue was that Hilary Duff concert at? Do you remember?
Yeah, it was in Winnipeg, and it was at, I think it's the Bell MTS Center now. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Famous arena that's been there forever. And mm-hmm. your first concert being an arena concert, did that make it weird once you started to notice that clubs and independent venues existed?
Yeah, that's a very interesting perspective. I think it did. I think as I started playing more gigs myself, realizing that it takes a long... You got to do a lot of work before you get to those stadiums. I personally never played a stadium. I've played some amazing theaters, but yeah, it's definitely motivating and humbling for sure.
Yeah, I can imagine, you know, my first concert was seeing Billy Joel in an arena here in Long Island, New York. I think my next thing was a theater. And then within a year of that, I was going to see independent punk rock shows at mm-hmm. places where there was no stage per se. And it's, you start to realize that the average person doesn't realize that that exists, mm-hmm. that kind of thing. And you've spanned different genres and playing, again, TV and that festival and this kind of club thing. Do you feel most comfortable in a particular kind of venue or live setting?
I don't think I've played enough shows, to be honest, to really know where my comfort is. But I guess for me, I will always be comfortable no matter how many people picking up my guitar and singing a song that I've written. And that will always be my first and foremost true authentic self. But it's so fun to put on a fun outfit and to dance on stage. And yeah, it's just totally different, but they're both super fun to do.
So if I can kind of translate that kind of sounds like, you want me to perform? I'll perform. Whatever it is to however many people it is, I'll do it.
100%. And I miss performing. So hopefully crossing our fingers, soon we can get back out there.
Cool. And three quick questions and then you're free for me. And the first one is, when you're not doing music, what is life like for you?
Yeah, life recently has been lots of, I've been keeping really active, just to keep my mental health in a good spot. So I love yoga. I love going for runs. I've been going for lots of walks outside with our dog. And yeah, just hanging out, living life.
Does that include, this is the second question, of course, does that include TV? And if so, do you have a favorite show from TV or streaming services that you could recommend?
Yes, I watched this a while ago when it first came out, but Queen's Gambit was so incredible. So I would urge everyone to go and watch that. It's the best series I've seen in a really long time.
Common pick right there. People love that show. And my last question here, and this can include as much self-promotion as you want. It's any last words for the kids?
Yes. Well, first of all, thanks so much for having me.
My pleasure.
Second of all, get enough sleep. Third of all, my debut album is coming out July 9th next month, and I can't wait for you to hear it. So you can follow me on socials at Olivia Lunny or Facebook, Olivia Lunny Music, and I'll be updating you there. So stay tuned.
Looking forward to all that. Hope to see you live in New York in the near future, but keep up the great work in the meantime, Olivia.
Thank you so much, and thanks for taking the time to chat. I really appreciate
it. My pleasure. Have a great rest of the day.
Outrocast.